الحمد لله الحمد لله ثم الحمد لله الحمد لله الذي هدانا لدين الإسلام وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له له الملك وله الحمد يؤتي الملك من يشاء وينزعه ممن يشاء بيده الخير إنه على كل شيء قدير وأشهد أن محمدا صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم أدى الأمانة وبلغ الرسالة وجاهد في الله حتى أتاه اليقين. May all the praise be to Allah, the one who guided us to this deen of Islam. And I witness that Allah is the only God, He is the only one who is worthy of our worship. He is the one who installs people in authority and the one who removes them away. The one who provides life and the one who provides death. I witness that Muhammad, may the peace and the blessings of Allah be upon him and upon his descendants until the day of judgment. I witness that he had received the revelation from Allah and that he had conveyed the message of Islam in the best manner a man could ever do. Only a few days ago was the memory of the event of the Isra, the 27th of Rajab, which passed only a few days ago. And this event, Allah Azza wa Jal installed in the Quran. It's an event that took place, and we read about it. It's a history, it's part of the seerah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. It's one of the major events in the history of Islam, in the progress of Islam. It's the time when Allah Azza wa Jal took his servant Muhammad, peace be upon him, in a journey from Mecca, al-Masjid al-Haram, all the way to al-Quds, al-Masjid al-Aqsa. And after that, Allah Azza wa Jal revealed the surah. And the surah is called Al-Isra. So what I want to do today is to look at the emphasis. There is an event, and there is a narration about the event. There is a talk. When an event takes place, historians talk about it. Today, media reported. And each and everyone looks at an event and takes a certain angle. From which angle I want to look at that event? What is it so important about the event? And the one who narrates, the one who reports the event, from his perspective, he picks and he chooses the most relevant issues that he wants to tie and attach or associate with that event. Allah Azza wa Jal, in the Quran, he talks about events. Like he talked about the event of Al-Fil. Remember the story of Abraha who wanted to destroy Mecca, and Allah Azza wa Jal revealed a surah called Al-Fil. And he described that from a certain perspective. That Allah Azza wa Jal chooses and He wants us to look at that event from that perspective. Similarly, the event of Al-Isra. We attend lectures, conferences, workshops, talks, parties, and we all, people, scholars, shuyukh, ulama, we talk about the event. About the event of the Isra and the Mi'raj, and we read the story, and we talk about all types of issues. But the most important thing, is how Allah Azza wa Jal described the event. What is it that Allah Azza wa Jal picked in this whole issue? The atmosphere of the Isra, when Allah Azza wa Jal took his journey, took his servant Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the journey, and then after he came back, Allah Azza wa Jal sends Jibreel with a surah called Surah Al-Isra. Let's listen to how Allah Azza wa Jal describes the event. Beginning, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. سبحان الذي أسرى بعبده ليلا من المسجد الحرام إلى المسجد الأقصى الذي باركنا حوله لنريه من آياتنا إنه هو السميع البصير. Beginning with this title, سبحان الله. The event is so great. The event is so huge. The event is beyond the imagination of us as people. Therefore, you are left with one word, Subhanallah. You know, sometimes when you see something amazing, something astonishing, something beyond your ability to perceive, you say, oh, Subhanallah. Subhanallah, this is great. Subhanallah, this is huge. Subhanallah, this is marvelous. Subhanallah, this is miraculous. Subhanalladhi asra. So there is no doubt about that. There is a glory in this. There is something great. There is something magnificent. Something marvelous. Subhanallah. Allah Azza wa Jalla takes his servant in a journey. And then he makes this first reference to a place in Al-Quds, and he called it a masjid. Al-Masjid al-Haram in Mecca and Al-Masjid al-Aqsa in Al-Quds. Until that time, there was no masjid in Al-Quds. Al-Quds has never been under Islam. There are no Muslims in Al-Quds. It was still dominated by Christians, by Bani Israel, by the Romans, but definitely no Muslims. But Allah Azza wa Jalla called that place Al-Masjid. A masjid meaning that there will come a time when this place becomes a masjid. When Allah Azza wa Jalla says it's a masjid, it will become a masjid. Even though it was not a masjid until that time, but it will be a masjid. Meaning the dominance of Islam will reach that far. The dominance of Islam will reach that far of Al-Quds and Palestine and the entire blessed land around it. الَّذِي بَارَكْنَا حَوْلَهُ. The place that Allah Azza wa Jalla blessed its surrounding. That's the first reference. And that's an emphasis. That Allah Azza wa Jalla wants us to look at the issue from the perspective that Islam will one day dominate that area, will reach that area, and that place becomes the masjid. And Allah Azza wa Jalla wants a connection between Al-Masjid al-Haram and Al-Masjid al-Aqsa. So today, when we look at this, and we read it, and we look at the issue of Islam, we have to recall the fact that Al-Masjid al-Aqsa today, the one that is in Al-Quds, when the people, they say, we want that place to be part of a Palestinian land. We tell them, no, wait, you are not getting it right. You have not read Surah al-Isra. You have not understood the implication of Surah al-Isra or the whole event of al-Isra. That place is not a Palestinian. It's not a Jewish. It's not Israel. It's not international. That place belongs to Al-Masjid al-Haram. There is a connection. Al-Masjid al-Haram and Al-Masjid al-Aqsa are twin brothers. They all belong to Islam. They all belong to the Muslim Ummah. They all belong to an Islamic entity. It's beyond the scope of nationalism. It's beyond the scope of Palestinianism, or Jewishism, or Israelism, beyond the scope of Arabism. It's an Islam. That's issue number one. Now also, when Allah Azza wa Jalla in the next few ayat, he immediately comes from the issue of Isra and the journey and the magnificence of the journey and subhanallah for that journey, immediately starts talking about Musa and Bani Israel. وَأَتَيْنَا مُوسَى الْكِتَابِ. The next ayah immediately. Going from Al-Isra to Musa alayhi salam, وَأَتَيْنَا مُوسَى الْكِتَابَ وَجَعَلْنَاهُ هُدًى لِبَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ أَلَّا تَتَّخِذُوا مِنْ دُونِي وَكِيلًا. There is a big jump. Big jump. From Al-Aqsa, from Al-Isra, from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, going into a journey, riding Al-Buraq, the Ayman that looks like, that has a face, a different face with wings, as described in the seerah. Going from that event, and the magnificence of the event, and its marvelous part which warrants from us, subhanallah, immediately to Musa alayhi salam. Musa was given a book so that he would guide Bani Israel. But they chose to be misguided. They rejected the guidance. And then Allah Azza wa Jalla also says, this is part of the dhurriya or the descendants of Nuh. Dhurriya man hamalna ma'ayu. So these are not people who came from Mars. They are the remainders of those people who were carried in the boat on the ark of Noah alayhi salam. People that Allah Azza wa Jalla designated to them a messenger, Musa alayhi salam, with a book, with guidance, to guide them, to show them the straight path. So Allah Azza wa Jalla is reminding us that even Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when he is given this issue of Isra and he is giving him the Quran, it's all about guidance of humanity. It's all about putting back the people on the track of guidance, as-sirat al-mustaqim. It's all about this. And even the significance and the marvelous and the miracles, all of this is to impress the people. To impress the people. So that they will be persuaded and convinced that Allah Azza wa Jalla is the one who is behind all of this deen. Muhammad, peace be upon him, cannot take a journey in one night going to Jerusalem and coming back. He cannot do that. Allah Azza wa Jalla is behind him. So Allah is behind all of this issue of humanity from the time of Nuh alayhi salam. And later Musa alayhi salam, and now Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, putting back the people on the right track to Allah Azza wa Jalla, on the right path. That is the perspective that Allah Azza wa Jalla is directing our attention to. Not only that. Now Allah is giving us a story of arrogance and a story of corruption and a story that people who could be given the guidance or the book or the scales, they could go wrong. And they could become arrogant. And they could become a cause of corruption. And he starts talking about Bani Israel. وَقَضَيْنَا إِلَى بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ فِي الْكِتَابِ لَتُفْسِدُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ مَرَّتَيْنِ. We have made a decree in the book that the people of Israel, the Israelites, they will have the power and authority. They will have the power and authority twice in their lifetime span. And in each one of these times, they will cause corruption and fitna and fasad. We gave them the chance. Allah Azza wa Jalla is telling us in the story that Allah gives people chances. He gives you a chance. He allows you to exercise power and authority. He gives you the time and the ability to have the resources and the authority and the power. And you will be even given the reasons to be guided. You will have a prophet, you will have a messenger, you will have a book. You will have guidance from Allah Azza wa Jal, but Allah Azza wa Jal will watch and see if you do good, then that's for your own goodness. But if you do bad, if you abuse your power, if you misuse the authority given to you, if you take the resources instead of putting them to the use of the humanity, you take these resources and make them against the humanity. Instead of making innovations and power and technology in order to make it better for the people of the world, you go and invent weapons of mass destruction in order to eliminate the people in one shot. Instead of inventing computers and technology to make things easier for the people, you provide an infrastructure for people to cause more corruption and more fitna and to create all types of scientific innovations in order to misguide the people. In order to create wealth that's beyond the ability of the people to produce. That you create wealth that eventually will be streamed in the hands of only a few. That you create economic infrastructure that allows people to be, some people to be more rich and the rest of the people to be poor. That's not why Allah Azza wa Jal gives you the authority. That's not why Allah Azza wa Jal allows you to exercise power. That's not what Allah Azza wa Jal wants you to do in this world. And this is what he is talking about Bani Israel in this surah. That's a perspective. A perspective that Allah Azza wa Jal wants us from this surah, from the Isra. Although it's an event that has to do with a journey. But Allah chooses in these few ayat to tell us, to direct our attention to an example in the history of mankind where a group of people were given the time and they were given the chance to exercise power, but they misused it. وَقَضَيْنَا إِلَى بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ فِي الْكِتَابِ لَتُفْسِدُنَّ فِي الْأَرْضِ مَرَّتَيْنِ وَلَتَعْلُنَّ عُلُوًّا كَبِيرًا. Allah talks about the very interesting the way he puts it. We have decreed for Bani Israel twice in the book that you will cause great corruption and great tyranny. Now you don't do corruption and tyranny until and unless you are powerful. So Allah Azza wa Jal skips the part that says you will be powerful and you will have an entity and you will have the strength and you will have the authority. It's given. The important thing is what do you do with that power? The important is not that you are becoming powerful entity or nation. There are many nations that have become powerful in the world. Today, the US is very powerful. Russia was very powerful a few years ago. China is very powerful. France, Britain, the Romans were powerful. Even the Muslim Ummah, they were powerful at one point of time, like the brother was talking in the previous khutbah. But if you do not exercise guidance and righteousness in this power, then the end result of your power is corruption. The end result of your power is tyranny. The end result of the power you have is oppression. The end result is aggression against the human being. Allah Azza wa Jal does not like that. And Allah does not allow this to continue. That's why in this surah, Allah is telling Bani Israel who have to do with the Masjid al-Aqsa even today, telling them that the fact that you have power and authority and you can cause corruption, this will not prevail. فَإِذَا جَاءَ وَعْدُ أُولَاهُمَا When the time for the first era to be ended, that Allah Azza wa Jal to take you out of this world in order to take out your power and corruption, Allah will designate a group of people who are servants to Allah, عِبَادًا لَنَا فَإِذَا جَاءَ وَعْدُ أُولَاهُمَا بَعَثْنَا عَلَيْكُمْ عِبَادًا لَنَا أُولِي بَأْسٍ شَدِيدٍ We will designate, we will raise a group of servants, ibad, servants of Allah, enslaved to Allah Azza wa Jal, worshipping Allah Azza wa Jal, who will come and remove your tyranny and your arrogance and your power. And even when you come back, if you get to power one more time, and you start exercising oppression and aggression one more time, Allah Azza wa Jal will repeat the same story. And will get the new people with devout devotion to Allah Azza wa Jal. With taqwa to Allah Azza wa Jal, the ones who worship Allah, they will come and eliminate that power one more time. And Allah Azza wa Jal puts it in a very nice manner. In أحسنتم أحسنتم لأنفسكم. If you do good, if you perform well in this world, it's for your own benefit. It's for your own benefit. وَإِنْ أَسَأْتُمْ فَلَهَا But if you do bad, then it's against your own interest. Same thing we say to the people today. When we look at this song, we look at this story, we look at this perspective, we say, aha, there are many people who have power today. The resources are being accumulated in the hands of a few. There is capitalism, there is superpowers, and you people, you have lots of power. You have authority, you have a nuclear arsenal, you have military power, you have great wealth, trillions of dollars, absolutely beyond even the imagination of our own brains. You have lots of money, lots of wealth, lots of resources. In أحسنتم, أحسنتم لأنفسكم. If you do good with this wealth, if you use these resources and authority to the betterment of the life of the humans, if you do something good for yourself and the people, then that's okay. Then that's good. But if you use these resources to terrorize the whole world, you remember those of you who are old enough, just like myself, during the Cold War, when the people used to live, go to bed and wake up in the morning with fear that there will be a nuclear warfare that can destroy the entire world. Today in the world, the nuclear arsenal that exists, the nuclear weapons, even for the young kids here, you should understand and know that there is enough weapons in the world. Not in Iran. They talk about Iran. Not in North Korea. They talk about North Korea. I'm talking about the weapons that exist in the US, in Britain, in Russia, in China. A huge amount of wealth, of power. If it goes at any point of time, it's detonated, the whole world is gone. That is terror. That is terror. Today, we have so much wealth in the world. Despite the financial crisis, despite the economic downturn, there are hundreds of billions of dollars. Brothers, I was reading an article. 495 people, 495 billionaires, they own $10.5 trillion. $10.5 trillion, that is about 25% of the total wealth of the world. That's too much. 1.2 billion of the world are poor. And if you want to be even more specific, 600 millions of those are Muslims. They are poor, they are hungry. So the resources that we have today, the ones who have the power, they are not using it for the betterment of mankind. They are not using it for the well-being of the people. Allah Azza wa Jal does not approve of that. The same way he told us about Bani Israel. When you exercise power to cause tyranny, al-ulu fil ard means tyranny, al-corruption, al-fasad means corruption. If you do that, that's not acceptable. That's not right. Allah Azza wa Jal doesn't like that. And today, when we look at the world around us one more time, brothers and sisters, the world around us is dominated by powers and authorities and people who exercise authority and power, not for the well-being of the humans, not for the well-being of the people, for the well-being of a few, true. For the well-being of few corporations or bankers, it's true, but not for the well-being of the majority of the people. When we read Surah Al-Isra, and we see how Allah Azza wa Jal immediately moved us from the event of the journey to the event of tyranny and corruption and exercising of power illegally, we have to understand and to realize that when we read the Quran and we look at events around us, we have always to look at the perspective that Allah Azza wa Jal wants us to look at. We can talk about the story. We can describe so many things in it. All of this is good. All of this is right. But then always come back and see how Allah Azza wa Jal chose, what type of ayat He chose about this. How He selected the event and then the associated facts that go with that. That will give us a perspective on how to read the Quran and how to understand our Islamic methodology. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله. Ask Allah for forgiveness. Alhamdulillah, may all the praise be to Allah. Before I conclude this, I just want to direct our attention to another slight issue here. When Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was taken into that journey of Al-Isra, it was around the 9th year in the Dawah. And it was after the death of his uncle Abu Talib, who was protecting him. After the death of Khadija radiallahu anha, his wife, the first one who believed in him. And he called that time when those two passed by, Amul Huzn, the year of grief. And the 2 years that came after that were one of the harshest years against Islam and the Muslims. Many Muslims, they left to Abyssinia. They migrated to Abyssinia because they were persecuted. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to Al-Taif and came back. He was chased out of Al-Taif. And he was beaten so many times in the vicinity of Mecca. It was very hard. And the glimpses of hope for the rise of Islam were so slim. They were so slim. Muslims were so weak, oppressed. Allah Azza wa Jal gives Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam this journey. He takes him to Al-Quds. He takes him up to a journey to the heavens. He shows him ملكوت السماوات والأرض. He sees everything now. And he comes back with this support, with this momentum, that this Islam is on the rise. Despite all of these weaknesses that goes undercurrent, all of those persecutions, all of those oppressions, all of that aggression against Islam, but Islam is on the rise. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba now, the Sahaba, they have this momentum, this strength, this power, this outlook, this hope. All of this fills their hearts and they move. And in less than 3 years later on, they have migrated to Medina and they built this very stronghold for Islam and the Muslims. And from that time on, Islam had been on the rise for so many years. The Islamic system was built, the Islamic laws were implemented, the Islamic jihad was launched, the land, even Al-Quds, was conquered, Al-Aqsa has become a masjid, and so on and so forth. We have to read and reflect, and to see where we stand today. And if we always, whenever we go through weaknesses, and the amount of oppression is mounting, there is always a hope and a support from Allah Azza wa Jal. Allah continues to exist and to continues to back up His deen. اللهم اني اسالك في هذا اليوم العظيم ان لا تدع لنا ذنبا الا غفرته ولا سيئه الا محوتها ولا خطيئه الا وضعتها. اللهم اغفر لنا الذنوب التي تهتك العصم. اللهم اغفر لنا الذنوب التي تبدل النعم. اللهم اعز المسلمين بالاسلام يا رب العالمين، وارحم المسلمين بالاسلام انك انت ارحم الراحمين، ومن علينا وعلى العالم اجمع يا الله بقيام دوله الخلافه الراشده على منهاج النبوه، يعز فيها اهل طاعتك ويذل فيها اهل معصيتك، ويحكم فيها بكتابك وسنة نبيك، إنك على كل شيء قدير، إنك أنت العزيز الحكيم. وصل اللهم على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت وسلمت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. Before I call for the prayer, just to let the brothers know that the brother who was supposed to give a khutbah today, the first khutbah, brother Faisal Hammuda, he was absent because he had open heart surgery. May Allah Azza wa Jal give him the shifa. Jazakumullah khair wa qumu aqim as-salah.